Hello, everyone. It's like with it's like what I said at the beginning of the Mass Effect Legendary Edition run. It's like we're returning to an old friend, a friend that I haven't seen in quite some time, and I've missed this friend, and I want to go through it again, for fun time's sake. Though there are other reasons behind that. And that kind of brings me to this intro for the series. So, let me kind of give you guys a little bit of background in case you perhaps have not seen my previous runs. So, years ago, I wanted to do a run through these Dragon Age games. This was before Inquisition came out. And I was hesitant, though. I was hesitant because there were things in it where, and this was at a time where I wasn't really sure about the landscape of how things were being evaluated on our videos and such on YouTube. This was also, I think, around the time when the content ID event or incident happened, where all of a sudden there was this big change to the system and bam, people's channels were having tons of their videos receive claims that they didn't have before. And it was just kind of this, like, oh my gosh. And, you know, people were also concerned about what kind of things you could have in your videos that were acceptable and what were not. And YouTube has gone through so many changes since I made those videos of this game in particular. One of the things I was very concerned about was, of course, when we got into the deep roads and we encountered the Broodmother, because, well, she's not wearing any clothing, and she has her, you know, she's nude in that. And I wasn't sure how YouTube's system and such was going to respond to that, if that was going to perhaps cause a flag on the video or something, or, you know, who knows. It was something I was, you know, that not just I, but other people were concerned about at the time. And I remember that was one of the videos that back then where you could actually flag a video for being inappropriate for younger viewers, before the whole thing that recently happened in recent years, where now you basically have to have your whole channel flagged for that or not. And I was hesitant about that, but I still went through with it because I loved this game that much, and this series. I love this whole series, even Dragon Age 2. I talked about that and in part one, and I still, still hold true to that. I, have even been replaying that in preparation for this run, and I still love the game. I still love all three of these games. Having some issues here and there, but yeah, my love for this series has not diminished in the slightest, and so I wanted to, do runs of these games on the channel. And since then, if you look at my most viewed videos, part one of that original run I did years ago of this game is still, I believe, the highest viewed video I've ever had on this channel. And, the parts that followed were also pretty highly viewed as well. So me doing a run of this game got a lot of attention. And it was something I just kind of caught me by surprise, and I was very, to this day, I'm very appreciative of that. Now, at the time, I, of course, did that on my PlayStation 3, and then I did Inquisition on PlayStation 4, mainly because that was all I had available to me at the time. I didn't have a PC to be able to play these games on, and even when I did, they weren't really in that great of a condition to actually play these. Even though Origins is an older game and can still run fine, getting some of the other stuff to run, as well as trying to get these games to run with mods, is also another separate issue, which is still something I'm kind of still working on even now. But if I've looked back at some of those other ones, one of my main issues that I have with those videos I did is the audio quality. It's something I'm going to try to really make better in this run of the games is to try to have the sound, you know, just be better, be a better quality. Just things sound better. My mic, I think I have a better mic this time around. Try and get the game audio and the balance of the audio as well. I also will try to do better work on the commentary. This was also, I mentioned the different state of YouTube back then. The other thing was that people were so unsure about trying to avoid getting flagged for non-fair use that the perception and idea at the time was that if you talked over the game more, provided more commentary, your video was less likely to get flagged for like a content ID match. So that's why I had a tendency to talk as much as I did in those videos, just because I was trying to avoid my videos getting flagged for any kind of copyright. I'm pretty sure at this point in time, that's not really much of an issue anymore, where now I can just kind of let the cutscenes and such just kind of speak for themselves and let the game dialogue kind of speak for itself, even though I still also say that's what the subtitles are for in case I do talk over something and you can still be able to, you know, read what was said. This is also in response to somebody who recently, you know, commented on one of the Dragon Age 2 videos who said that if they had been watching this years ago, they would have asked me to not talk over the dialogue. And that's why I had to explain that particular aspect. So, but things are different now. And, you know, at least that's how it's believed now, that things are kind of different on YouTube these days, where that's not necessarily the case. So, yeah, so, despite the audio dialogue, and the audio quality issues I had, those were essentially like my canon runs, my good canon runs, which I still, stand by the choices and how I played those. I really enjoyed those, getting to show you guys what it was like. Just as a recap, in Origins, we played a male dwarf noble, who did the usual good choices and such. I showed you what it was like for a dwarf noble to go ahead and side with his brother Balin instead of Harrowmont, having that confrontation and such. I believe we had Alistair rule by himself, if I recall. And I tried to show you guys all the DLCs I could. In Dragon Age 2, we had Hawk as a mage. So two things. One, so I could show you the Mage Templar thing from the perspective of Hawk as a mage, feeling directly involved, as well as showing you Carver's side of the story, because usually Carver's side of the story doesn't get shown, because a lot of people usually play DA2 as either a warrior or a rogue, and thus we'll have Bethany with them as well. And that's kind of what's going to happen in this run. I showed you, Carver's side of the story. I wasn't necessarily interested in focus on Carver or Bethany. I was mainly focused on what is the story of DA2 like if Hawk is a mage himself. And that was kind of the intent there. So, and in the process, I showed you the story of Carver, which is not really as interesting compared to, say, with Bethany. And I'll, be trying to show you guys the differences when we get to DA2 in this run. Since I will not be playing a mage, obviously, and we'll have Bethany with us. Though Hawk in this run is going to be different than the Hawk I showed you guys last time. I'll get to that when we get there. And then when we get to Inquisition, I showed you guys another dwarf, a rogue, and showed you, I believe we sided with the mages. I'll have to recap some of the other choices I did. And I've tried to... Here's part of my issue with Inquisition. I've tried to play through that game multiple times on multiple characters like I did with Origins and 2. The issue is that Inquisition is so big. There's a lot of running around and a lot of resource gathering. You know, how much time have you guys spent in Inquisition running around in places like the Hinterlands, spamming the search button, looking for things like elf fruit and other things like that for crafting? In my opinion, you spend way too much time doing that. And when you have to do stuff like that, because you kind of have to, it feels tedious, and it starts to feel like a chore, and it starts to feel boring. And that was part of my, and that's part of the issue I've had with Inquisition trying to play through it multiple times. Now, hopefully I've been able to come up with some solutions to that, because as time has gone on, not just for how I'm able to do things here, but EA has kind of also changed things, such as, for example, it is now easier to mod Inquisition compared to what it was like when it first came out. Now, I was playing on a PS4 at the time, so this wasn't a concern for me. But on PC, it was apparently extremely hard to actually mod Inquisition, until later on, they let up and they relented and kind of released an official mod tool for people to use if you got mods for Inquisition, and then use that in order to try to install mods for Inquisition. Because even, you know, the thing is, the Dragon Age games, you can mod them. They're just not officially supported for mods. This is not like how it is with Elder Scrolls. Elder Scrolls is, and I believe Fallout as well, is entirely supportive of mods. And so is XCOM 2, by the way. There's tons of mods for Skyrim, tons of mods for Oblivion. There's also tons of mods for Morrowind. There's tons of mods, I believe, also for Fallout 4. And I believe also Fallout 3 in New Vegas, though getting Fallout 3 to run is a whole separate issue. And compare that with these games. There's tons of mods for XCOM 2 as well. But that's because Bethesda supports mods for those games, even though they've also started implementing the official mods by them. That's a whole other separate discussion. There's no official mod support for Dragon Age, not, you know, discounting the official mod tool they released for Inquisition. There's tons of mods for, well, not nearly as many Skyrim, but there's quite a few mods for Origins, DA2. Not as many mods for Inquisition, but I believe that's because maybe, I don't know, interest kind of waned on making mods for Inquisition. But there is quite a few mods, and if you can be able to get to work, you can find the mods on Nexus Mod Manager, and Nexus Mod Manager does support modding for Origins and DA2. It just doesn't do it for Inquisition, which is why you need the official mod tool for that. So I have been messing with this because, well, mods have kind of added a whole new extra experience to a game like Origins for me, a game that I know so well and have done so many runs of and know so many of the different choices and outcomes and such, and yet adding mods can just add and change, you know, add to or outright change the experience that you can have with a game like this. It's one of the things I like about this whole modding experience in general, not, you know, for Dragon Age, for Skyrim, for XCOM 2, for Total War Warhammer, just mods can just enhance and add to your experience. And it's totally optional. You know, I understand that there are some people that they hate the idea of mods existing, to which I say you don't have to use them. Now, if you're opposed to them existing at all because, you know, for whatever reason, like, you know, an example, I guess, would be if, let's say, if you added a mod for, say, Star Wars Battlefront, which turned Darth Vader's armor into pink, and then you had pink Darth Vader. You know, there's some people that perhaps would oppose that because they think it's disrespectful to the character and the lore and all that. And then there are some that would think that that's just, it's just a fun little gag, little fun little thing. You know, is it really hurting anybody to have a, you know, that they want to add a mod to just color Darth Vader's armor pink? I don't think so. You know, that's their choice. They found the mod themselves and they chose to download and install it. And that's, you know, what's so bad about that? You know? That's just my personal take on it. If you don't like mods, just don't use them, you know, but don't try to take them away for those who do want them. You know, it's, you know, Let it be optional for people who do want them. That's my take on it. And so because of that, I'm just going to let you guys know that, of course, whereas those original runs of these games that I did on my PlayStation 3 and 4, this time we're going to be doing them, of course, on the PC, and we're going to be doing them with mods to both change some things I want, like get rid of the giant spiders. Oh my gosh. I always hated how the spiders looked in these Dragon Age games, and then I found out about the mods that you can just change how they look, like, you know, the mod in Skyrim, and I was like, oh, thank goodness, I'm getting that immediately. So we no longer have to see gigantic spiders in these Dragon Age games. And I just, anytime I can find a mod for that for a game, I'm like getting it immediately. I am also going to be using some mods that are going to make the experience far easier. Yes, I do have some, like, cheat mods and god item mods, just so you guys know. If you have an issue with that, you know, just... I will say, though, I'm not using them to beat this game on nightmare difficulty, okay? I do understand if people have an issue with me using them to beat the game on a higher difficulty. Because then that's just straight up like, okay, you're just kind of... Because if you get the achievement for it, you didn't really beat the game on that high difficulty. You cheated your way to it. And I can understand that. But if I'm playing it on the easiest difficulty, like casual, is it really going to matter? You know, at that point? Because I'm playing on the easiest difficulty anyway. I'm just going to go ahead and have some extra fun with some extra god mode items or cheat items. You know? Or items that just make some of the, you know, get money or resources just less of a grind. You know, I'm all for getting those kinds of mods. So I'm letting you guys know that up front. If you have an issue with me using mods, you may not want to watch this series. Because it's going to happen. Okay? and also to give you guys kind of an idea of what I am doing. So I was unsure of what I want to do in terms of what kind of characters to play for this. So I actually started reaching out to some, you know, to people. I asked you guys in a video what you would want me to see me do. I also went, you know, to some other kind of like, you know, social media stuff involving, you know, where Dragon Age fans kind of gather groups and such, like a Facebook group. And I, you know, sent out a poll and I asked for them, like, you know, to vote on this poll of what would they want me to see me do here on the channel. And the majority voted. And this just started to make more and more sense to me the more I thought about it because, well, even though there are some runs of this on YouTube, probably not as many as you think. How many runs are there in comparison, you know, of you doing the quote-unquote bad or quote-unquote evil choices compared to the usual good choices, which... You know what they are. In Origins, it's you side with the mages, you side with the elves, you side with the dwarves, you side with Caradon over Bronca, you destroy the Anvil of the Void, you side with Haramont, even though he's not good for the long-term future of the dwarves. I add that. That's why I always side with Balin. Even though Balin's pretty awful, but still. He's not, you know... I'll talk more about that when we get there, in terms of how I see Balin for the Dwarven people of Orzammar in comparison to Haramont. But anyways, and of course you win the Landsmeet and you get rid of Loghain and you either put Alistair on the throne, those kinds of good choices. How often do you see people do runs where they side with the Templars or side with the Werewolves? Or side with Bronca and keep the Anvil. Or side with keeping Loghain around. You don't really see it that often. There's not that many out there. At least I don't think there are. And the same thing is with the other ones. The other games. You know? You could essentially refer to this run as a pro-Templar run. Because I'm basically planning on having a side with the Templars in all three games. Even though I'm planning to play a Kunari mage in Inquisition, I'm still wanting her to side with the Templars. I'm working on an in-character reason as to why she would side with the Templars or recruit the Templars as opposed to recruiting the mages. But then again, the more I've been kind of testing out and playing through Inquisition, especially the early portions, the more it actually starts to kind of, I can see how, considering the way the things are going with the Mage Rebellion, her talks with Vivian, and it just, I could see how she would be going, you know what, maybe I shouldn't count on these Mage Rebels. Maybe I should go with the Templars instead, get them on my side. Even though I am a mage and a Qunari, maybe I should get them on my side. And, you know, one of the main reasons is because I want to show you what happens if you side with the Templars instead of the mages going forward in the, you know, through the rest of Inquisition. So, I mean, I contemplate playing other things, you know, in Inquisition, but I like the mage gameplay, well, in all three Dragon Age games. That's, you know, but when it comes to Inquisition, I've already shown you guys what it's like to play as the rogue. At least the dual-wielding rogue. I mean, I could do an archery rogue, but I don't really feel like playing a rogue again in Inquisition. And I'm not too fond of the warrior in Inquisition. I'm fine with playing a warrior here and in DA2, and that's what we're going to be doing. So the plan is this. We're going to be playing as a male human noble warrior here in Origins who... How do I put this? He's not a goody-two-shoes, and he is okay with making choices that would benefit him, and some choices that perhaps he... it's something I'm still working on in terms of how his particular character, you know, and how he certain views certain things and why he would do certain things or side certain things. But, it, you know, it, the deep down, the actual, like, out-of-character reason is because I want to show you the alternate choices. Plus, you know, he's going to make some of those choices. Like, he's going to side with the Templars. He's going to side with the werewolves. He's going to side with Bronca and having her keep the anvil so we can also have golems in the final battle of Denerim. He is going to want to marry Honora so he can also be on the throne of Ferelden alongside her and keep Loghain alive, because if he's going to marry Honora, he wants to, of course, please his future wife, right? And keep his future father-in-law, right? Plus, it also allows me to show you guys what happens if you keep Loghain around going forward. Plus, if you want to take him with you to the Return to Ostagar DLC. Because usually you do that with Wynn and Alistair and the dog, but I have a mod that makes it where you can just bring the dog regardless of a full party or not. You don't have to take up have a slot for the dog. You just get a free slot for the dog. So anyways, you could wait until you get Loghain, then do the DLC and bring Loghain with you. And he has unique things to say when you go back to Ostagar, as you would expect him to say. You know, when you find some of those things, like the documents about Orlais and what Caelan was going to do, he has a reaction to that because he didn't know. So this will allow me to show you what happens there. And when you encounter him in Awakening later on, what he has to say. And then, of course, spoilers, you get to encounter him in Inquisition if you kept him around and kept him alive and had him stay, you know, become a warden. So that's kind of what... this run is going to kind of be. Also, I believe in Awakening, we're going to stay with the Keep and not go save Amaranthine. Just because I think this guy would want to keep the Keep as like one of his own kind of personal fortresses, you know, as the Warden Commander, rather than save the city of Amaranthine. That he'd want to make sure that the Keep that he has been working on to stay up and forget about that city. So that's the kind of the plan I have for... Oh, also, even though he's going to marry Honora, he's going to romance Morrigan. So I showed you guys my dwarf noble he romanced Leliana the first time. This time, I'm going to show you the Morrigan romance. It's kind of cute and adorable, but yeah, you can still marry Honora and still be able to be in a romance with Morrigan. Morrigan's not going to care. And of course it's going to make the scenes where like she asks you to you know, make the godchild from the archdemon, which we then see later on in Inquisition, that's going to be a thing. This will also show what the difference is in Witch Hunt, though he's not going to go with her through the mirror at the end of Witch Hunt. You can do that if you wanted to, especially if you're in a romance with Morgan, but he's going to stay because, well, he has responsibilities helping Honora run the Kingdom of Ferelden, doesn't he? So, even though he wanted to see Morgan, he still has to keep his own personal power running Ferelden alongside Honora. So, that's that, you know. So, that would just already spoiling it for you, that ending there. So, then we would move on to Dragon Age 2. And Hawk in that one, it's going to be Femme Hawk, because I want to give her voice actor some love, since I played a male last time. And this time, we, of course, I considered playing a rogue again. I have some fun mods I found for DA2, especially some weapon mods, which, let's just say there are a couple of notable weapons that I found that made me kind of torn between playing either a two-handed warrior or a dual-wielding rogue. And I was kind of going, I've been going through the warrior just to kind of test it out, see how it is. And I do honestly like the gameplay of the two-handed warrior in DA2. I do like the gameplay of rogue as well, but it just kind of fits. Plus, I actually ended up just kind of like favoring the weapon. You know, when you see the weapon, you'll know what I'm talking about. For the two-handed warrior, oh, I've got a fun weapon in mind to run around with in DA2. Just wait till you guys see that. And this Hawk is also going to be very aggressive. We're going to be going the aggressive route. She's no nonsense, no BS, just fed up, just tired, just angry about everything. And she's going to romance Fenris, by the way. And it's personally my favorite romance in DA2. I think it's well done. Plus, of course, I love Gideon Emery. He's just such a great voice actor for Fenris. And, of course, she will side with the Templars, which will let me show you what happens when you do after you defeat Meredith and how the Templars respond and how Hawk gains a extra personal seat of power in Kirkwall as a result compared to if you side with the mages and bolt out of there. And then we will move on to Inquisition, which I'm still working on that and kind of putting the pieces together, but at this point, I feel like I am confident enough in terms of how I would do Origins and DA2 before we move on eventually to Inquisition. So, that's to give you guys a heads up of what to expect in these runs, to let you know right up front whether or not you want to stick around and watch these runs of the Dragon Age games, or if you'd rather just bow out and go find something else, or watch my original run and not see me make some choices that perhaps you may not like. But again, this is also partly to just show you what else, you know, what happens if you do make the alternate choices. What happens if this happens, you know, if you make this choice, you know, stuff like that. Now, I'm not going to make every alternate choice. There are still some choices I'm still going to stick with. We are not going to put the dragon blood in the urn of sacred ashes. We are not doing that. I've done that choice, and I hated it. I hated doing that choice. And spoilers, if you have Liliana and Wynn with you, they will turn on you the moment you do that and try to kill you to avenge Andrasse. And yeah, that can lead to, if you kill her, Liliana, she then shows up in Inquisition because, of course, she's still there. You can ask her about it, and she'll comment on that and talk about how much she hates the Warden. So, it's horrible, and it's one of those choices, you can sort of get away with it if you don't bring them with you, but you still risk them just straight up leaving the group. I'm not intending on making any choices that are going to cause people to leave the group or force me to kill them. Like, I'm not, like, when I side with Bronca over Carradine, I'm not bringing Shale with me, because she'll just instantly turn on me. Whereas if I do that without her there and then go to camp and talk to her, I can talk her down out of it and still keep her alive and in the group. So, yeah, I'm not doing every alternate choice, because some of them are just outright awful. And, you know, it's like, some of those choices are kind of gray, you know, like siding with either the Templars or the Werewolves. I mean, it can be labeled as evil, but is it really in comparison to, say, in the City Elf origin story, letting that piece of filth have his way with your cousin and just having him offer you money to just leave and then you take it. I mean, I consider that worse. Oh my gosh. And I can understand why the City Elf videos I did, those have gotten a lot of views as well. And I can understand why, because oof, looking back on it, that is just very uncomfortable stuff. And there's some other horrible choices, like the Tevinter Mage is offering you to like teach you things like blood magic and let, or to sacrifice the slaves there to empower you or something like that, or for you to just to pay you off to let them take the slaves back to Tevinter. I mean, those are some pretty horrible choices, and those are choices that my character would be like, no, I'm putting my foot down on this one, you know? So he's not going to be like the most evil thing you've ever seen. I'm sure there are plenty of videos and such out there to showcase those kinds of things, okay? So, in case you're wondering, thinking this is a full-on evil run, no, this is not like that. It's I'm showing you alternate choices, but he's not like a horrible, just terrible, terrible person, you know? in case you're wondering what I'm intending to do for Redcliffe, I may let them overrun the city. Although I do have a mod that helps make it easier to win that and make Lloyd not die, since it's so easy for him to die so you can get the reward. And probably have Jowen sacrifice Isolde, because I hate Isolde, to help save Connor, you know? As opposed to getting the mages to help with that. Nope, forget that. And I guess I would probably have Morrigan take care of that. These are kind of the choices that, if you're wondering about, that's kind of what I have in mind. So, if that's something you'd like to see, I hope you stick around and enjoy this alternate run of the Dragon Age games that I love very dearly. And I'm still very proud of those runs, even though I think the quality is hard to bear sometimes. I don't blame any of you if you have tried to watch those older Dragon Age videos I did, and it was hard for you to do so because of the audio quality and how I did the audio for them. That's just kind of what I was dealing with and working with at the time. Sorry. That's why I'm hoping that the quality of this run will be better, you know, at least in terms of the audio. So I hope you guys stick around and enjoy this run of the Dragon Age games, and I'll see you then.